morning, everyone. As Professor Kumar said, I am actually an alumni of AIT extensions, not quite 30 years ago, but 14 years ago. If it was 30, I would have been 12 years old, and I think that I'm not any kind of wonder kid in that way. But I did spend 3 weeks here on campus, learning about project management and M&E, and it was right at the beginning of my UN career, so it really shaped the way I looked at project management and M&E. So it's nice, not very nice to be back. I'm very honored to have been invited to come and speak to you about innovation, or at least the innovation in the way that we approach it at UNDP. I'll talk not only about our work here in Thailand, but I'll show you, I'll give you some examples of the innovation work we are doing around the whole Asia-Pacific region. Innovation is really become the buzzword of the decade in the worlds of business, education, and so on. Politicians and large corporations and universities and other parts of society, they all agree that innovation is the key to the future. The term innovation has actually become kind of the default response of executives and politicians and educators when they're asked, what do we need to be successful? They all answer more or less, well, we need innovation. A study conducted by an Australian online magazine called The Smart Company found that the word innovation or innovate was the most used business word in international online media in 2015. And number two on the list was collaboration. So the title of this event actually contains the two most buzzy business words in online media in 2015, which is not bad at all. You should get some good hits on Google when people search for collaboration and innovation. Now, I'm aware that innovation, when we talk about innovation in the public, it's often associated with the private sector, and it's often associated with research and development, and is focused mainly on bringing economic benefits. And so you might ask yourselves why I'm standing here today. Because UNDP do social development, we don't do corporate development. Well, I'm here today because, well, first of all, I was invited to come, so thank you again. Secondly, because we firmly believe that innovation should not only have an economic impact, it should also have, probably more importantly, a social impact. It should not only benefit the bottom line of the big companies, but should have a positive impact on society. And we call it, and I'm sure you call it too, social innovation. At Stanford University in California, they have a Center for Social Innovation, and they define the concept of social innovation as a novel solution to a social problem that is more effective, efficient, sustainable, or just than current solutions. The value that is created by social innovation accrues primarily to society rather than to private individuals. Now, how do we address this in Thailand and in the Asia Pacific region? Well, before I get to the examples, just allow me a bit of sort of contextual background. Asia-Pacific region has really seen remarkable economic and social progress in the past 20 years. Between 1990 and 2008, more than 700 million people were lifted out of poverty in the region. And the average GDP growth in developing Asia has surged ahead of other regions. Now, this prosperity, however, has failed to reach all sections of society. Nearly two-thirds of the world's poor still live in the Asia-Pacific region. And the next tranche of gains in the region are threatened by persistent development challenges exacerbated by climate change and rising inequality. The relative importance of the drivers of economic growth and of prosperity have evolved over time, and for a growing number of countries, innovation in its many different dimensions has emerged as a leading driver to economic growth. Building on this, the appetite for reform, the increasing demands of equal footing, partnerships with middle-income countries and other developing countries, UNDP believe that we are well placed in the region to actively respond and engage with national and subnational governments and other partners to actively provide technical know-how and mentoring support in developing innovation capacity to co-design and co-develop the next generation of services to address critical national development priorities. Globally, innovation has made a huge difference in addressing urgent and pressing development challenges, such as by addressing, by responding to climate disasters, by improving avenues to engage citizens in political processes and governance, and by promoting more transparent and responsive governments. In recent years, we have we're seeing a world that is increasingly functioning in real time. And the use of information and communication technology has become increasingly widespread and has not only resulted in improvements in economic productivity, but has had crucial impact on governments looking to provide more citizen-friendly, transparent, and accountable people-oriented public services. In the last 2 years, our efforts at UNDP on innovation has been more concentrated with modest investments to encourage our staff to experiment with new ideas outside of our traditional project cycles. We're being asked to challenge business as usual and engage with new and non-traditional partners. And I'm happy to report that despite a few challenges along the way, the outcome looks very promising, and we've had a lot of success in terms of new user-centric solutions that have been prototyped. Non-traditional partnerships have been formed, and we've gained quite a bit of media attention and a fresh thinking in the way that we design our projects and the way that we conduct rapid prototyping and testing. In our efforts forward, we're continuing to push the boundaries by exploring alternative financing instruments through, for example, the establishment of the UN Social Impact Fund. And we're also experimenting with new mechanisms such as forecasting-based financing and so on. We're also witnessing an increasing demand from the private sector on technology for good initiatives that allow for exploration of the new use applications in development for areas like the Internet of Things, virtual reality, augmented reality, unmanned aerial vehicles or drones, as well as from governments for setting up innovation labs that deliver public services through improved citizen engagement and collaborative design. Through our regional innovation ambassadors program, we're continually improving our in-house innovation capacity and skills as we engage with governments and other partners to design the next generation of development solutions. I'll give you a few examples of some of our innovative solutions across the Asia-Pacific region. First of all, in China, using big data and mobile phones, we partnered with Baidu to link end users and legally certified e-waste disposal companies for safe recycling of electronic waste. We developed this through an iterative design process and rapid prototyping, and the version 2.0 of the application is currently available in 22 cities across China and has led to safe disposal of almost 6,000 electronic items every month on average. The application continues to gain popularity. We have over 250,000 searches every month. And recently we launched the Baidu Recycle Green Service Alliance, comprising several major Chinese and international companies, as well as the China Resource Recycling Association, to build an internet-based nationwide e-waste management system. This initiative has gained quite a bit of global recognition. It emerged as a semi-finalist in the MIT Climate Lab contest, as well as being the winner from over 800 entries to the Solutions Summit. More recently, this initiative has also been selected by the UAE government to be featured in their fourth World Future of Government Summit. In Nepal, after the earthquake, UNDP partnered with Microsoft to develop smartphone applications that monitors reconstruction efforts in real time and ensures that poor families in the Cash for Work program are paid accurately and on time. The application facilitated consistency of data collection, secure data storage, enhanced project management and planning, and it aided in transparency and collaboration between agencies. The application helped demolish and remove debris from over 3,000 houses. It employed over 3,500 local people and benefited around 70,000 community members. In Bangladesh, using behavioral insights, we identified that unreliable information was the key deterrent to using public transportation. This led to a partnership with the Bangladesh Road and Transport Corporation and a local startup called GoBD to prototype GPS tracking buses that helped commuters access real-time traffic data and better predict public transport reliability. Since the new bus finder feature was added on one bus route with the GoTraffic application, it has been downloaded over 500,000 times, and the actual use is at about 200,000 times by commuters. We're now partnering with the behavioral science team, which has been seconded from the White House, to further study the application usage and potential nudges for public transport usage. In Papua New Guinea, we partnered with the Mobi Media Australia to develop citizens' monitoring tool for corruption. After a successful pilot in 2014 with approximately 1,200 staff within the Department of Finance, at the national level, which covered widely by ABC Radio Australia, the Phones Against Corruption Services has been rolled out to incorporate more civil servants in 2015. And by the end of December last year, almost 22,000 SMSs were received from over 6,000 different users. Six new departments have been incorporated, involving approximately 25,000 government officials countrywide. In the Maldives, we received pro bono support from Fix My Street in the United Kingdom to develop a crowdsourcing tool called Make My Island, to create dialogue between residents and councils on the islands of the Maldives by crowdsourcing reporting of issues such as streetlight damages, mismanagement of waste, and improved service delivery. Since the prototype in September 2014, it's been scaled up to cover 4 islands, and within the first few weeks of the official launch of the mobile application, more than 64 issues were reported and addressed. Complaints can be sent via mobile phone or on the website, mapped digitally, and the council is then alerted of the issues most important to citizens and priorities action, and they prioritize action accordingly. The government is now intending to scale this up to all islands in the Maldives. In Bhutan, UNDP has prototyped a service in partnership with the government to connect parliament with citizens. It's called the virtual Zongdu, named after Bhutanese tradition of meeting among residents of villages and communities. It uses the existing structure, infrastructure of community centers to host meetings via video conference to enable citizens across Bhutan to virtually meet their parliamentarians more frequently. And during the scale-up in 2015, video conferencing facilities have been installed in 47 community centers across the country. And this has been implemented by community consultations and training of over 260 community members in 4 sub-districts. Now, lastly, but absolutely not least, if you ask me, in Thailand, UNDP last year piloted 2 different social innovation challenges. First, in the area of disaster risk reduction, and after that, in the area of anti-corruption. Both campaigns followed the tried and tested process or methodology of, first of all, identifying the issue. Second of all, the idea generation phase. Third, incubation. And fourth, prototyping and testing. And that's where we are at the moment in both of these campaigns or challenges. In the disaster risk reduction challenge, which received great media coverage from Thai PBS, amongst others, we identified out of, I think, 30 entries, 5 ideas, mostly non-tech based, which were put forward for prototyping and testing with a little bit of seed money from UNDP. One has unfortunately since dropped out, but the 4 remaining teams are working very hard to perfect their products, and we have in fact received quite some interest from potential investors to take the prototypes to the final stage of the innovation process, which is scale up and impact. I'll talk a little bit about that, more about that later. The anti-corruption innovation challenge also produced a wealth of ideas, and 9 of these ideas have been through the incubation phase, and they are all currently working on prototyping and testing. Interestingly, compared to the DRR, the Disaster Risk Reduction Challenge, which was mostly non-tech based, all of the ideas that came in the Anti-Corruption Challenge were tech based in one way or another. And again, we have a couple of very, very promising products that may attract both public and private investments to take them to scale. Now, based on the experiences of these 2 challenges, and with clear conviction that Thailand is ripe for systematized social innovation, you might call it, UNDP will later this year be launching a social innovation lab in partnership with Intel and with CASEAN, the Creative ASEAN Center in Ratchada. And we're also exploring further potential partnerships with Software Park, with the National Innovation Agency, with Windrock International, with Leo Innovation Lab in Denmark, with Change Fusion, with Mazi Club for Change, and other private sector and venture capital companies who may see potential in investing in social innovation. Now, of course, partnerships with academic institutions such as AIT are clearly an opportunity that we would like to explore. And based on the presentations this morning so far, I think there's a great potential to form some sort of partnership. Now, the lab is conceptualized around what I call the five basic tenets of successful collaboration. Number one, and what I think is most important, is engaging unlikely bedfellows. Number two, creating a resonant vision, cultivating relationships, communicating across worldviews, and commitment to ongoing learning. The lab will bring together a very diverse group of institutions, but we'll bring them together around one common goal, and that is to create social innovation and social impact in Thailand. The lab will have a physical location. Obviously, we'll have a lab. From where we will run our innovation challenges, but it'll also be a space for learning and for capacity building for young people to bring their ideas to life. We'll conduct seminars and workshops and hackathons, and we'll have a series of mentors and advisors from various walks of life, from the development world, from the business world, from the startup world, from the more technical world, on hand to help the young people move their ideas, move from idea to impact. Part of the lab will also be a virtual space, a repository of knowledge and experience from around the world on social innovation, on tackling development issues, and it'll be a space for virtual mentorships and lectures from international renowned experts in various fields who will connect virtually and not necessarily have to travel to Thailand to engage with the young people. A third part of this facility will be the Innovation Challenge Hub. We will conduct two or three innovation challenges a year, following the four steps of social innovation that I described earlier. And obviously, both the physical and the virtual spaces of the facility will be play an important role in this as well, both in terms of gatherings and mentoring, but also in terms of prototyping and testing. The fourth and final part of the facility is perhaps the most important if we are looking to achieve social impact. This is the social impact investment and equity window, where we will bring together impact investors, accelerators, and public and private entities to hopefully take some of the ideas that come out of our challenges and take them to scale. Because not until they're brought to scale will we see real impact. So there it is. It's the Thailand Social Innovation for Development facility, opening soon at a theater near you. I truly hope that some of you here today will find this interesting, and I'm very happy to discuss further with anyone who might be interested in getting involved, either as individuals or institutions. UNDP in Thailand have now integrated innovation into all of our projects in one way or another, and we have current plans and work going on to work on sustainable consumption and production, innovation in biodiversity conservation, environmental conservation, in risk information, and so on. Now, there's no doubt that innovation and technology are already playing a really important part of economic growth. But let us take this momentum and apply it to social development issues as well. Let's innovate and use technology for social good. Let us use it to get affordable housing, for high impact talent management, for capacity building, skills development, disaster risk reduction and mitigation, transports, road infrastructure, logistics, supply chains, sustainable development in general, sustainable development in the context of urban planning, of food and agriculture, and much, much more. Let's bring together these unlikely bedfellows and create social impact in Thailand. I hope that this conference will be successful and that great ideas will be brought to life. I've been sneak peeking at the agenda and I think there's some very interesting finalists and I look forward to hearing more. I look forward to also hopefully work with many of you in the future for Thailand's social development. Thank you very much.